Hello, welcome back to Sunday School Lessons, provided to you by the Tennessee Baptist Convention. My name is Travis Biller. I'm the pastor of Emmanuel Baptist Church in Elizabethton, Tennessee, East Tennessee. And I welcome you again. Glad you're joining with me today. And we're beginning a new series of Sunday School Lessons. I think through September, Mark will have to clarify for me, but I think it's at least sometime in the fall, at least through the summer. But I'm glad to be back with you and sharing with you in God's Word. Today, we're in the Gospel of Luke, starting in chapter 3. And the title of today's lesson is called Prepared. It's about John the Baptist and his message. He came to prepare the way of the Lord. And as he does so, he sounds the alarm by way of warning to get the attention of the people so they will be prepared for the coming of the Messiah. Being warned is probably something maybe we don't always give thought to, but warnings are important. I remember years ago, I think it was in 1991, I was on active duty. I was in the Army, stationed at Fort Lewis, and me and a friend drove up to British Columbia in Canada, and we were driving back, and I had this old Datsun pickup truck. And I think it was a model from the late 70s. At any rate, we're driving back. We're coming up to around Seattle. We're in I-5 going south back to Fort Lewis. And a warning light came up on my dashboard. And it said that the engine was overheating. We stopped. We put some water in it, in the radiator, and thought, oh, we're good. Kept on driving. The light came back on. I said, you know, I think we can make it to Fort Lewis. Well, I was wrong. We didn't even make it out of Seattle. And the engine overheated, and it didn't just overheat, but it actually seized up. So I completely destroyed the engine. It just detonated the engine. Pulled over to the side of the road, and I opened up the hood, and all the steam is billowing out. The engine got so hot that the cap on the radiator had melted off the engine. It was just kind of sliding off to the side, and it was like molten metal was just kind of oozing off the aluminum there. It was so hot it melted the aluminum that holds the cap on. So I would have done well to have heeded the warning of that little light that came on. And because I didn't, I lost that vehicle. The engine was permanently lost. You know, John the Baptist came to warn. And he came to warn us because he doesn't want us to be lost. You know, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son that whosoever should believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. And the Bible says it's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And that's really the key word here is repentance. That's the message of John the Baptist. It was the message of Christ. It has been consistently the message of the church for 2,000 years. And it is appropriately the first word of the gospel. The very first word of the gospel. And so we're going to look at this warning that he gives to the people as he seeks to prepare them to meet the Messiah. Of course, we know the Messiah comes to bring salvation. He comes to bring good news. But it's important to understand that the good news is only good against the backdrop of, well, the bad news, right? The bad news is that the wages of sin is death. And essentially, the preaching of John the Baptist, and really the first words of the gospel, are meant to warn people so that they will respond to the good news. And so that in responding, they will not be eternally lost and destroyed from the presence of the Lord in the lake of fire at the end of the age. And so what an important message that we have here. It is central to the gospel, and it is one that we do not want to neglect. And in our day and age, neglecting the message of repentance, the first word of the gospel, I think is something that we can easily do. We want to love people. We want to tell them how much God loves them. We want to tell them of the great work that Jesus had done for them. But sometimes it's difficult to tell them that outside of Christ, people are doomed. Outside of Christ, there is no salvation. And outside of Christ, there is no forgiveness of sins. And Christ came to deal with sin. Sin is the issue. Sin is the reason the gospel has been given. Sin is the reason people, all people, stand condemned unless they turn to Christ, who, as we know, stood under God's condemnation on our behalf. So we don't have to be condemned. So let's read. The lesson starts in verse 7. I want to back up just a little bit to verse 3. And the first point that the writers in the lesson give, they just call it warning. John the Baptist comes to warn. And I want to just back up and start in verse 3 and read through verse 9. And we're just going to talk about it as we go through here, but starting at verse 3, speaking about John the Baptist, it says, he went into all the region around the Jordan, preaching the baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. Of course, we know that. As it is written in the book of the words of Isaiah the prophet. But what I wanted to point out here just real quick is that Isaiah 40 is quoted. And what's interesting is that Matthew, as he writes the gospel, he basically summarizes the meaning of these first few verses out of Isaiah 40. And notice how he summarizes it, and he uses that to summarize the message of John the Baptist, right? He comes preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins. And then he says, as it is written. And then he goes on to say, the voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, making his path straight. Every valley shall be filled, and every mountain and hill brought low, and the crooked places shall be made straight, and the rough way smooth, and all flesh shall see the salvation of God. What's really interesting is that obviously it refers to John the Baptist seven centuries to be exact, before he showed up. But centuries before the message was to come, the voice of one crying in the wilderness. But notice what it says, prepare the way of the Lord. Now, what I want to just point out here, it should be obvious, but notice Matthew's summary, preaching a baptism of repentance for the remission of sins, and then compare that with the words out of Isaiah. And what's interesting is that the word repentance isn't used in Isaiah, but clearly under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, as Matthew is writing, that's what he sees in these verses. And what I want us to see specifically isn't just that he was the one crying out in the wilderness, although that is who John the Baptist was, but his purpose was to prepare the way of the Lord. Prepare the way of the Lord for what? He goes on to give geographic descriptions. Did he come to literally prepare a road in the middle of the Judean desert so that he could have a nice road to walk down to preach people? Well, of course not. We know that's not the case. So the following commentary isn't about geography. It's about the human heart. And it's preparing our heart to meet the Lord. And that's what repentance is all about. The message of repentance, which again is the first word of the gospel. So if I was to ask you, what is the first word of the gospel? It is repentance. What is the purpose? So that we are prepared to meet the Lord. So I want us to consider something as we read the rest of these verses and look at the message of John the Baptist. The message of John the Baptist isn't a one-time message that we need in our life. We don't just hear the message of repentance and believe on Jesus, then go on our merry way. We hear the message of repentance, and then our response, as we're going to see in the second point, is to live the message of repentance. And I want to submit that maybe we need to live it every single day. And I believe that if we are allowing the gospel to be a living reality in our life, and that's opposed just to be an intellectual reality, if we're allowing the gospel to be a living reality in our life, then we need to be preparing our hearts every day through the message of repentance. And this becomes the first step in living out the gospel. And the reason we do that is because, well, none of us has arrived. Somebody give me an amen. Not a single one of us has arrived. But listen, one day we're going to arrive in the presence of the Lord, and we want to live a life pleasing to him. You know, and the Bible talks about in the book of Corinthians that there are rewards in heaven, but it also talks about there are people who are going to basically not have rewards because their works are going to be burned up by fire, and they're going to be burned up because they weren't really the things of God. And it's easy for us to get distracted. It's easy for us to invest in the things of the world to the neglect of the things of God. And the result is the world comes into our hearts, and that's where our true love is. And the result is that we're really not growing in the things of God and probably allowing sin to take over in areas of our life. And sometimes it even goes unnoticed and unchecked. And so the message of repentance confronts us. And John the Baptist, He seemed to be a confrontational figure. His message confronted people. I mean, it just kind of smacked them upside the head, as we're going to see here. And they had to make a decision. And I want to suggest that part of the gospel intends to confront us, because we need to make a decision about various things in our life, choices that we're going to make, activities that we engage in, and even the things that we choose to think about. And we have to choose to repent of the things that are not pleasing to God. So let's continue on with what he's saying. So obviously, so his purpose is clear. He's trying to prepare people for the Lord. And we can't be prepared to meet God without repentance. And so look at verse 7. Now, if you're a pastor watching this, or you're a member of a church, how would you feel about being the pastor? Or if you're a member of a church, how would you feel if your pastor came out and the first words of a sermon to visitors, you know, with all this COVID stuff going on, things are probably a little different in terms of visitors. Hopefully you have some. But, you know, I've been in churches where visitors come in, and I hope you don't do this as a church, by the way. If you're a visitor, stand up. I've been in churches. I remember when I was young, I was a non-believer in the church, the pastor. If you're a visitor, we want to greet you. And they had, you know, all the visitors stand up. And I think I was like the only one who stood up, and I was horrified and embarrassed. So don't ever do that. But how would you like to hear the pastor call out to the visitor, stand up and say, brood of vipers, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now, I don't know, but I suspect that if the pastor greeted the visitors, there would be a meeting that day on the phone, maybe. The deacons probably would get together, or if you're an elder-led church, the other elders would get together, and somebody would want to talk to the pastor about his greeting etiquette. Am I right? And yet, this is the message of John the Baptist, and this is what I mean by it. It's just incredibly confrontational. A lot of times, we don't like confrontation, but here's the thing. The gospel demands an element of confrontation. Was he saying this? Was he calling out? Notice who it says, to the multitudes. Was he yelling out to the multitudes because he was just kind of an angry man and he didn't want them to be there and he didn't love people? Now, it would be easy to interpret that language, brood of vipers, as an unloving statement. But what if it wasn't so much an unloving statement as it was a truthful statement given out of love for the purpose of warning the people who heard it? Warnings are important, and it's easy, like I shared at the beginning of this message, the warning on my dashboard in my old Datsun engine in 1991. I ignored the warning, and I seized the engine as a result, and I lost the truck. But what's lost as a result of warning this message is so great, far greater than losing a car. To not heed the message of repentance is to be lost in the fires of hell forever. And so it's a zero-sum game. If you heed the message, you gain everything. But if you ignore the message, you lose everything forever. And this is really, I think John understood the significance, because he didn't just call him a brood of vipers. He said, who warned you to flee from the wrath to come? Now, today, we don't like to talk about wrath. We don't like to talk about judgment. When we talk about God, we want to tell people how much God loves them. I mean, I started this message off by quoting John 3:16, God so loved the world. But I also pointed out that that message has to be seen against a backdrop of God's judgment and wrath. We don't like that word. And oftentimes, even us pastors, we're guilty of it. We shy away from it, and we ought not to shy away from it. And John the Baptist is a good example. You see, at the end of the day, he wasn't preaching to win friends. He wasn't preaching because he wanted likes on a Facebook page. He was preaching because he was a steward of something. God had given him a message, a stern message to be sure, but a message that had to be delivered. And the people had to hear it because God so loved the world. And absent hearing the message of repentance, they would never be prepared to meet the Messiah. It was true then, it's true today. And let me repeat myself where I said this was the first word that John preached. But when Jesus begins to preach, it's the first word that comes out of his mouth. That's the first word of the gospel. When Peter preaches his first sermon at Pentecost and they say, what must we do to be saved? Repent and be baptized. So that was the message of the early church. It's the message today. It has always been consistently the message of the gospel. And so he's not being rude. He's being loving, but he's being confrontational. And sometimes confrontation is demanded because sin is so severe and the consequences of sin are eternal, which is, as John says here in verse 7, the wrath to come. It is a reality that one day God is going to pour out his unmitigated wrath. The book of Revelation said he's going to pour out the full cup of his wrath. Can you imagine the horror? Just as God's love is eternal, God's wrath is eternal. That's why hell is eternal. So he's preaching this message to the people, and there he says in verse 8, notice what he says, therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. And do not begin to say to yourselves, we have Abraham as our father, for I say to you that God is able to raise up children to Abraham from these stones. All right, let me just paraphrase this real quick. God's not interested in your religious resume. Somebody give me an amen. He's not interested in how many times you've gone to church. He's not interested in the committees or the ministries you've served on. He's ultimately interested in our heart, right? He wants us to give our lives to him in love. And he wants us to love him above all things. The Bible makes it very clear. But notice verse 8, this idea, there's kind of a contrast here. It's not our religious resume that God's interested, but notice what he says in verse 8, therefore bear fruits worthy of repentance. We're getting to the end of the lesson here. You notice that basically the same message is still there. We're to bear fruits. What does that mean? It means our salvation always manifests itself in a lifestyle lived before God. And that's really the point of the second point, which is called response, starting in verse 10. We'll look at that in just a second here. But our response to repentance isn't just I believe. Our response is that belief fundamentally transforms me. And here, John the Baptist is saying, don't trust in your religious heritage. Look instead to see if the gospel is bearing fruit in your life. You know, and a theological note, you know, the Bible tells us that when we put our faith in Christ, God puts a spirit within us. And by virtue of his spirit within us, Paul says in Romans chapter 6, his life begins to flow out of us. You know, we're grafted into his life. That's really the language that Paul uses. And the result of his life being grafted into us is that his fruit now comes out of us. Paul talks about the fruits of the Spirit in the book of Galatians chapter 5. And I'm sure you're familiar with that. And this is essentially what John the Baptist is saying. Again, I just want you to notice the consistency of the message all the way out through Scripture. But so if true repentance is taking place, it means true change is going to take place. Of course, you know the word repentance. It means to change your mind. The analogy is often used. You're walking down the road one direction. You change your mind and you turn and you go the other direction. And that's a good analogy. But it literally means to change our mind about ourselves, about our sin. And it does mean that we agree with God against ourselves. And it means that we agree that the wages of sin are death, and specifically the wages of my sin are death. And if God was to give me what I deserve for my sins, I would experience his wrath against me. That's repentance. So it means, A, I stop sinning. I mean, that's pretty obvious, right? I stop sinning. I make an effort. I'm not going to sin anymore. Through the power of the Holy Spirit given to me, I'm not going to sin. B, I'm going to begin to live for God. I'm going to begin to live for his will. And that will be seen now, as he says in here in verse 8, bear fruits worthy of repentance. And he says in verse 9, and even now the axe is laid to the root of the trees. Therefore, every branch, here he repeats himself, every tree which does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. Well, this stirred the hearts of the people, obviously. So he's preaching, repent, recognize the wrath is coming. And then because you've repented, allow your life to be fruitful for God. And so now the people hearing this, they respond. And so we see this response starting in verse 10. So the people asked him, saying, what shall we do then? Now, you can go through and read the response that John the Baptist gives to different groups. But one of the things I want you to notice is that there's the tax collectors, there's soldiers. So there's different people he's responding to. And here's what he's doing. He's giving them a specific response. Now, what does that mean? It means that for every person's life, there will be a tangible change exhibited in their life. For the tax collectors, he said, don't collect any more than what's appointed for you. In other words, stop stealing from people. And so for them, their repentance had a specific visible response that other people could quantify, if you will. They were doing something, they're not doing it anymore. And the same thing with the soldiers. And so the question we could ask ourselves is, if we repent from sin, what does that look like? What is it that God wants me to stop doing that's displeasing to him? And again, something I hadn't mentioned so far, but who is John the Baptist speaking to? A bunch of lost people? He's speaking to a bunch of Jewish people who believed that they were, by virtue of their Jewish heritage, good in the eyes of God. So they believed God, they were religious, and they thought they were okay, right? So it's important to understand that context, because it's the same message that we send to the church today. Because we're in church and we believe in Jesus, we have to be careful that we don't neglect the message of repentance and think, well, I'm good, I can rest on my laurels. Now, I'm not advocating that we work for our salvation, but I am advocating that our salvation produces a life that's pleasing to God. In fact, that's what the book of James says, right? James, who was the pastor of First Baptist Church of Jerusalem, he says, "What does it profit, my brethren, if someone says he has faith but does not have works?" And then he asks a question, can faith save him? Or really, it could be translated, can that type of faith save him? And then he goes on to talk about specific things. If a brother or sister is naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you says to them, depart in peace, be warmed and filled, but you do not give them the things which are needed for the body, what does it profit? Thus also faith, if it does not have works, is dead. But somebody will say, you have faith and I have works. And he responds to that by saying, show me your faith without your works, and I will show you my faith by my works. And so genuine faith always expresses itself in specific, tangible ways, and it's going to be different for different people. One, we're going to repent. The sins that maybe beset you aren't the sins that beset me, so repentance may look different for you than it does for me. Just like in the response here, the people who were asking, how do we repent, he gave different answers to different people. And so my sin may not be your sin and vice versa, but repentance may be something we still need to be working on a daily basis. And then repentance bears fruit, and it's going to bear fruit differently for us as God leads us, and the works that he's called us to may be different from one another. But the point still remains, our life is fundamentally transformed because of repentance. And then he finally goes back and he gives another warning again. And that's the last point. It's not called warning, it's called division. And it's in verses 13 through 18. And the division isn't between people and God. I mean, between people and people, it's between people and God. And he talks about basically at the end of the age, there's going to be a division of people. There's going to be those who are condemned because they didn't flee the wrath to come because they didn't repent. And then there's those who are saved. So let's read. And he said to them, collect no more. I'm sorry. Yeah, verse 15. Now, as the people were in expectation and all reason in their hearts about John, whether he was the Christ or not. And John answered, saying, no, I indeed baptize you with water, but one is mightier than I. I'm sorry, but one mightier than I is coming, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to loose. Now, here's the thing I want you to say. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. There's a division there. Holy Spirit, those who are saved, we see in Pentecost. They received the Holy Spirit, and it did appear as a fire on them. But I think there's a division here, because I think fire refers to those who aren't saved. He is going to baptize with Holy Spirit and fire. And I think the next couple verses, justify that interpretation. Verse 17 says, his winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly clean out his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn. Those are those who receive the Holy Spirit. But the chaff, he will burn with unquenchable fire. Those are those who receive fire. They're judged. And then it says, with many other exhortations, he preached to the people. And so in those final verses, they asked him, are you the Messiah? No, I'm not. But when he does come, you're going to notice he makes a distinction between people. The one who created all things, who's the Messiah, he is the creator. He is God in the flesh. In him, the fullness of deity dwells. And he loves you so much, he came to offer his own life as a sacrifice for your sins. But if that is rejected, the only thing that awaits is fire. And so there is a distinction that God makes amongst people. You know, as the church, we would do well to remember that. God makes a distinction between those who come to faith in Christ, those who trust in the salvation that was offered to them through Jesus Christ, and then from everybody else. And everybody else who denies the gift of salvation, who denies the Son, who fails to repent and turn to the Son, excuse me, all that awaits them is fire. And his winnowing fan is in his hand, and he will thoroughly cleanse out his threshing floor and gather the wheat into his barn. But the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. That's a hard message. It's not one that we like to say. But if we're going to share the gospel faithfully, we have to balance it out. God does love the world so much that he did send a Savior. But there is no salvation in any other name under heaven. And it's only through Jesus Christ that all people can be saved. And they can be saved. They can receive the Holy Spirit. They can receive the forgiveness of sins. But they have to repent. And failure to repent will result in becoming chaffed and experiencing the judgment of God. The church was created. We were called to warn the world. And the message of John the Baptist is still the message of the church. We have to prepare people to meet the Messiah. I think Charles Spurgeon, I like how he said it. He said, I preach judgment, or I preach law until there's no hope. That's really what John the Baptist was doing. Then I preach grace until there's no doubt. But the two complement each other. And for the gospel to be really understood, for the good news to be good news, the message of repentance has to be proclaimed. The wrath of God has to be understood. And the purpose for which Jesus came and died must be revealed. And when that happens, then it becomes good news. Then the Holy Spirit is given as people confess him. Listen, thank you for joining me. I know this went a little long, but thank you for joining me in our Sunday school lesson. I look forward to seeing you next week as we continue in the book of Luke and to just grow with each other and to fellowship in the Word of God. God bless you. I love you. Thank you for joining me. Bye-bye.